Get to the top of it. All right, what I want to do first is just because we wanted to see maps and see where things are at. So let me just once again give you some maps there. And this is a map of Paul's third missionary journey. But the reason I do that is I just want to give you a perspective here where this section of Asia, which is Western Turkey, is where the churches that we're talking about are at. And then here's more one that's more specifically showing the churches, from Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis. And now we're going to talk about Philadelphia and Laodicea tonight. And if somebody was going to make a circle, they could then shoot back across from Laodicea back over to Ephesus. So we're going to talk about Philadelphia tonight. And you didn't realize there was a Philadelphia someplace else, did you? You thought maybe the one in Pennsylvania was one of a kind, but no, there's a Philadelphia in there's probably lots of them throughout the world. And this one had a strategic location at the junction between several trade routes. And because of its strategic location, it became an important city of commerce. In fact, the imperial post, like the postal route going from Rome over to the eastern part of the empire, went right through Philadelphia. And as a result of that, it was sometimes called the gateway to the east. The gateway from the west, which would be Rome and Greece, Italy, and then going on to the east, which would be, where Israel was at. And that made it very important commercially. It was also a place where the land around it, because there had been some volcanic activity, was well suited for growing grapes. And it had a good agriculture, had a good industry, and it really enjoyed a considerable amount of prosperity. The main god that was worshipped was Dionysius, and that's the god of wine, and among other things. But there were other, Bacchus. Is Bacchus the Greek and Dionysius? I don't know, but that was the main god there. And there were other gods there as well. There were some hot springs there, and it was interesting. There are earthquakes around there. And we don't live in that part of the world, but that part of Turkey is subject to earthquakes. And so Philadelphia had an earthquake in AD 17, and they got to get help from Rome to rebuild the city. The church there seems to be small, but of a good quality. And its enemies were from the outside. There's no mention of any kind of false teaching going on there, any kind of immoral behavior, no factions, no heresy. And in a way, it had a lot to do in common with the church in Smyrna. It's one of those churches that did not receive any blame, but only got praise. It suffered, though, by those that were called Jews, who would be described as not really being Jews because they were not one of the heart. And they got some persecution from the Romans. But the opposition was outside, not inside. So that little bit of background, let me read Paul's letter to the church in Philadelphia. Here's what he says. These are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David, that what he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I place before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Since you've kept my command to endure patiently, I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come on the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. I am coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. The one who is victorious, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God. Never again will they leave it. I will write on them the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God. I will also write on them my new name. Whoever has ears, let us hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So that's the entirety of the letter that was written to the church in Philadelphia. Let's go back now. Let's work our way through it verse by verse. Now, again, normally when Christ identifies himself at the start, he used something from the vision back in chapter one. But once again, maybe Christ uses everything, but he doesn't use something from that vision. He uses something from a different source. And so here he identifies himself in a couple of ways. He's the Messiah, the true Messiah, who has the keys in his hands. Those keys control access to the kingdom of God. Now, the NIV says these are the words of him who is holy and true to describe the risen Christ. A more literal translation of the Greek would say, these are the words of the Holy One, the true one. And in Jewish culture, a holy one was a familiar way to describe God. If you go back in the Old Testament, you'll find places where God is described as the Holy One, and you'll even see it in the New Testament as well. And he joins the Holy One to give Christ the status of God with the phrase, the true one. Now, true can mean some different things. In its classical sense, it meant something that was genuine. And it's probably used that here because he's basically saying, I am the true one. I am the true Christ. Even though the people, the Jews of Philadelphia might say, I'm the false Christ. He's saying, no, I am the true one. I am the genuine. And also, if we take from the Old Testament, the sense of what it means to be true, it is kind of more the sense of faithful. It reminds the believers in Philadelphia that not only has Christ been set apart to carry out his messianic task by God, but he can be counted on to complete it. He is faithful. Christ is described as the Holy One, God, but he's also the true one, the genuine and the faithful one. The next way Christ is described here is one as having the key of David. And this is just a metaphorical way of saying that he has complete control over the royal household. The background from this is probably Isaiah 22:22, where Eliakim receives the key of the chief steward of the king's household. He's the representative of the king, and so he has the authority to administer everything in the king's household under the king's name. And in fact, when you look in the passage in Isaiah 22:22, it says, "I will place on his shoulder the key to the house of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open." And the concept there is just that he has complete control. And so Isaiah's language is used here to present Christ as the Davidic Messiah who has complete control over entrance into the heavenly kingdom. Whoever he opens the door to, that door will be open. And whoever he closes the door to, that door will be closed. And probably this is important reassurance to the Christians there because many of them who had been Jews before probably have been excommunicated from the Jewish synagogue, told that you're not welcome, don't come back. The Jews were claiming that they were the true people of God and that they held the kingdom, the keys of the kingdom of God. And John is basically writing Jesus' words here where Jesus says, I'm the one that has the keys and I'm the one who really has control. And the one who has mine are the ones that I will enter into the true kingdom of God. Don't pay attention to being rejected by those who call themselves Jew because you've been accepted by me. I am the one that really has control. Christ alone and no longer Israel can give people entrance into the messianic kingdom. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one is able to open on their own. And so these words are basically kind of a commentary on having the key of David. Christ has been given absolute exclusive power to give entrance and to exclude people from the kingdom of God. And as we see many times in the letters, there'll be a reference to, I know your deeds. And the good deeds of the Philadelphia church are not further described. But it is one that's filled with good works. And we know that because she's pleasing to the Lord. The church had little strength and was small, had very little influence, but they had the character that was so great that they're only commended. And the Lord does not give them any correction or any chastisement for their behavior. Now, this verse 8, where it talks about an open door, before you an open door that no one can shut, there's some discussion about what it means there. You know, it's very common in missionary activity to talk about having an open door as having the possibility to spread the gospel. And so some think that John is saying here, hey, I'm giving you an open door because, you know, you are in the keeper of the gateway to the east where the imperial road passes through you. You've got great opportunity to carry the gospel to other parts of the land. And that's possible. But I think maybe a better interpretation would basically go back to the concept of the keys, that God has opened the door to them, that there's an open door for them to be part of God's kingdom and nobody is going to shut it. So don't feel threatened or intimidated by the Jews or the Romans. You have shown yourself faithful. I have the key. I've opened the door. I've included you in God's kingdom. So don't fear those who say that they will exclude you or keep you out of God's kingdom. No matter if the door of the synagogue has been closed to you, a better door, the door to the kingdom of God, a door to the future heavenly Jerusalem that will come here, that's the door that's open to you, and it's never going to be shut. They may have little strength, but they faithfully kept Christ's word, and they've not denied his name. Therefore, they are confident that the door to his kingdom is open to them. And it's interesting when you look there, and we're going to look at this in just a few moments in the next few verses, but basically they'll learn that the threefold reward for their faithfulness is they get vindicated before their foes, they get delivered from a final difficult period of testing, and they have security in the age to come. So let's push on over now to verse 9. Here's what he says there. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, who claim to be Jews, though they are not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Now, this does show that there was a conflict between the church and the synagogue in Philadelphia. The Jewish population was convinced by their national identity and their religious heritage that they were the people of God and not those people who were claiming to be Christians. But we know, though, we've already seen this as we've been looking at similar things elsewhere, that Paul makes the case elsewhere that a man is not a Jew if he's only one outwardly. A man is a Jew if he's one inwardly, and circumcision is a circumcision of the heart, not of the flesh. It would be the church in Galatians chapter 6:16 that would be called the Israel of God, for the Jewish nation had forfeited that privilege because of their disbelief. And we looked at in Romans, where it talks about the wild olive bush and how those were broken off and the Gentiles were there. So the members of the synagogue, even though they claim to be Jews, in a spiritual sense, they are not. They are liars. In fact, they are slandering and persecuting the Christians. And by doing that, slandering and persecuting those that are really God's people, they are showing they're actually a synagogue of Satan. Jesus had said before the hostility of the unbelieving Jews showed that they belong to their father, the devil. And therefore, later in Revelation, we see Satan is labeled the accuser of the brothers. So it's little wonder that in this place, those Jews that were persecuting the Christians and their synagogue would be called the synagogue of Satan. Similar thing happened to the church in Smyrna. But notice he says, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Now, in the Old Testament, you'll find passages where the Gentiles, the heathen nations, where it said about them that they will come to Israel and they will acknowledge that God is with them. It's interesting here because there's almost a reversal, because the Gentiles who now believe in Jesus are the ones that are part of God's family. And so now it's being said that the Jews who should believe in Jesus, and remember, many Jews did believe in Jesus, but those Jewish unbelievers and those pagans who didn't believe will be the ones that will eventually come and acknowledge that the Messiah loved the church, that Jesus loved the church, and he gave his life for the church. Now, there's no indication of when this acknowledgement will take place. Some think it really just means that a bunch of Jews will get converted, and when they get converted, they will say, yeah, you know, you were right. Jesus really is the Messiah. But that doesn't kind of convey the concept of retribution that's kind of here. The underlying here is really more in line with Philippians 2, where it says that the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And we know that passage says some are going to bow the knee joyfully and are going to bow the knee because they repented and turned to Jesus. And some are going to bow the knee, but it was too late and they missed the opportunity to repent before they were forced to acknowledge that Jesus was Lord. Once again, he acknowledges in verse 10 that they've kept his commands and they've endured patiently, and they're going to get a reward for that. They had going to be a reward for that. And that reward is that they will be kept from the hour of trial that is coming on the whole world. Now, again, this is one of those passages where the two main viewpoints kind of disagree. Because if you're going to be kept from the hour of trial, some people say the way to be kept from the hour of trial is to be taken from the earth and be in heaven when the hour of trial and difficulty comes. Other people say, no, to be kept from the hour of trial means that you'll be kept safe in the middle of the hour of trial. And actually, the Greek doesn't really help us decide which of these are really the key meaning here. But this is a big distinction in the interpretation of Revelation, and we're going to get into it next week. And the distinction really is when we see the time of tribulation being described in Revelation, were the Christians on earth during that time, or have they been removed during the earth? The big issue in interpretation Revelation is, do Christians go through the tribulation, or are they taken out before the tribulation? And we're going to focus on that beginning next week for a little bit. We won't look at a lot of verses specifically in Revelation, but we'll look at verses in Daniel chapter 9 and 1 Thessalonians that address those issues. But here's the thing that needs to know. The trial is going to be a very thoroughgoing test. It'll be a test of the whole earth and a test of all who live on the earth. And usually when John uses phrase like that in Revelation, it's a reference to the heathen world, the unbelieving world, that it's going to be a test on them. But it's not a test when the goal is simply to punish and judge them, but it's a test to prompt them to repent. It's something that's given to motivate them to turn back to God so they can avoid the wrath that's coming and the punishment that will be there. And these tribulations and difficulties are kind of like foretaste and say, this is what's going to happen if you don't repent. Unfortunately, most don't repent. So let's push on now to the next verse in chapter 11, where Jesus again says, I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. And here are the words, I'm coming soon. And here it's not a threat of judgment, but it's a promise more of Christ's second coming. And again, soon, we think it always means chronologically, but when it's used prophetically, it just more conveys the idea, I am definitely coming. I will come. I will be there. And he gave this promise, a very similar promise to the Christians in Thyatira. Now, the coming of Christ to Ephesus, though, was that if you don't get your act together, I'm going to come in history and bring bad things on your church and maybe move your lampstand. And in Pergamum, he says, I'm coming. And that was, I'm going to fight against you with the sword of my mouth if you don't straighten up. And in Sardis, he said, I'm going to come, but I'm going to come like a thief. But the come, and that was more a coming of judgment in history, not the end times. But the coming to the Philadelphia church is basically more that end time coming. And he says, I will keep you safe in the time of trial. And I'm going to do that because you are citizens, permanent citizens of the eternal kingdom. And to some degree, the fact that they have to be kept safe during the trial does seem to imply that they're going to be there and have to deal with that. But we'll talk about that more when we get into it next week. He says, I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. And again, I think we've talked about how crowns can mean two different things in the Greek culture. There could be the crown that a king would wear, and that's more of a royal crown, or is the crown that was more of a victor's wreath, a victor's laurel that was put on the head at the end of an athletic contest. And that's more what's going on here. You have been faithful, and you are faithful, and therefore you have a crown that acknowledges you, that you have been victorious. You have resisted sin. You have resisted giving in to temptation. You've resisted denying Christ. Keep it up. Don't let anyone take that away from you, because there's some blessings that are going to come to you if you do that. And those blessings are rewards. And one of the rewards to those that are victorious is to be made a pillar in the temple of God. Now, that doesn't mean he's going to turn you into stone and put you there. It's really just a figuratively way, a symbolic way of saying that you will be with God forever. In fact, the concept of a temple, being pillars in the temple, gets repeated a few times in Revelation. And obviously, it's symbolic, being part of the temple of God. And it also, you know, some of them might say, it's a contradiction, because in the New Jerusalem, there's not going to be a temple. So how can you say they're going to be a pillars in the temple of God, but there's not going to be any temples in the New Jerusalem? And again, that's taking things that are meant to be symbolic and figuratively and trying to make them concrete. Being a pillar in a temple simply means you're never going to leave God's presence. You see, the pillars in a temple, a place where God would dwell, they are always in God's presence. They never leave. They're solid. They're firm. They're established. They're not being removed. So basically, John is saying that for you, because you've been faithful, you are going to be sturdy and solid in God's presence forever. Don't have doubts. Don't have fears. Don't worry about it. Now, it's interesting, this concept of being a pillar there in a temple, you know, might also be relevant to them, because they were a place that had some earthquakes. And when earthquakes go, you know, the roof usually comes down, but a lot of times the pillars remain standing. And so it was just kind of about something they could relate to, of something being firm and solid, something that will always be in God's presence. They also go on to say that here are some other blessings or promises to you, because you have been victorious. You have been faithful. You've not, right, Jesus. Christ will write on them the name of God, the name of God's city, and then his own new name. And just think about that for a minute, what that's really talking about here. When they have God's name on them, it means they belong to God. And that's a good thing to know, that you belong to God, because God takes care of what belongs to him. God values what belongs to him. God accepts what belongs to him. And so to basically have God's name on you means that you belong to God, and that is a sign of security. Having the name of God's city on us basically is a reference to having citizenship. is basically saying you are and will be citizens in the New Jerusalem. You're citizens in the heavenly Jerusalem now, but one day the heavenly Jerusalem will come and be on earth. And then having Christ's name written on them indicates that they have a special relationship with Christ, a unique relationship. I know you remember Toy Story, there were toys. And what one thing that was really special was when Andy put his name on you, right? You had Andy put his name on Bud. That was kind of a special thing. And so having Christ's name on us is another indication that we have a special and unique relationship with Christ. And then, as always, they wrap up the letter by saying, whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And again, it's saying this message is to the church in Philadelphia, but it's not just to the church in Philadelphia. It's basically a letter and promise to all churches. And those promises that are given to them because they are victorious, he's given to you. That faithful people will be rescued in difficult times, that faithful people have God's name, you know, written on them and are citizens in the New Jerusalem and have an intimate relationship with Jesus. We're in a sense part of a temple that God indwells. So he is never gone from us. We never leave his presence. You know, if you went to a physical temple, you may say it's great and wonderful while I'm here, but you have to leave. But when you are the temple, the good things you experience never have to end. Well, let's push on and go on to Laodicea. That's the last one. But once again, just want to show you the map there so you can see the relationship. You know, they're going down from Philadelphia to Laodicea. And again, Laodicea was a place where three important roads came together, and that created its prominence not only as a city of industry, but it also was a city of banking. For some reason, that location was a good place for commerce and banking. And it was really a very, very wealthy city. In fact, it was probably one of the wealthiest cities around. And the reason we know that is because they had an earthquake, you know, kept having earthquakes in that area in AD 60, 61. And normally when an earthquake happened, a city would need to appeal to Rome to help rebuild. Laodicea didn't need to do that. They had all the money they needed to rebuild their city from their own resources. Didn't have to go to the federal government and see if Congress would bail them out and give them some money. They had all they needed there to take care of themselves. The city was famous for a beautiful black wool cloth that they made, and it was turned into clothing, into carpets. It also had a flourishing medical school, and it was particularly noted for ear ointment and also for what was called Frisian powder, which was manufactured to be kind of an eye salve to help people with their eyes. Now, Paul did not visit this church, at least that we know of in scripture. It probably though, excuse me. It was probably founded by Epaphras of Colossae. And he is made reference to in Colossians. He is in the church in Laodicea. In fact, Colossians says that he wrote a letter to the church in Laodicea when he was in prison in Rome. So in Colossians, he says, you know, see that this letter that I'm writing to the Colossians is read to the church in Laodicea, and get that letter from Laodicea and see that it is read to the church in Colossae, the Colossians. Unfortunately, we don't have the letter he wrote to Laodicea. You know, he makes reference to it, but we don't have it. In fact, there are some other red letters he wrote to the church in Corinth that we don't have. Now, why don't we have those letters? I don't know. Maybe Paul was having a bad day and he wasn't listening to the Spirit and said some things he shouldn't have said. So God made sure it didn't get preserved and copied. But it does indicate something about that church, that there was kind of a connection there with the missionary activity that Paul did when he was in Ephesus. Now, in Laodicea, there is no mention of persecution from Roman officials, no mention of troubles from the Jews, no mention of any false prophets and teachers in the church. Basically, it was kind of like Sardis. It was more a problem in that it was an example of nominal, self-satisfied Christianity. The difference seems to be that in Sardis, there still remained a kind of a nucleus of people that really still had a vital and vibrant faith. It seems though like the entire Laodicean church was really complacent and had problems. There wasn't this core remnant that really was doing it right. Many of the members probably became apathetic because of their wealth and their participation in the affluent society, and that economic vitality and enjoying all that kind of deadened their spiritual life. This is the church that receives probably the severest a condemnation of all the churches and all of the seven letters that were written. So let's go and look at the words that are written there and talk about those. So let me read it all the way through, and then we'll go back and start looking at each verse. So Revelation 3:14, to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, these are the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish you were either one or the other. So because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. You say, I am rich, I have acquired wealth, and do not need a thing. But you do not realize you are wretched, pitiful, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire so you can become rich, and white clothes to wear so you can cover your shameful nakedness, and salve to put on your eyes so you can see. Those who I love, I rebuke and discipline. So be earnest and repent. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne. Whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Okay, let's go back and look through the verse a little bit more in detail. Again, notice the author, notice Jesus identifies himself with three affirmations. He's the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the ruler of God's creation. Now, the normal Hebrew adverb that is rendered by the Greek amen means to acknowledge that something is sure and valid. It kind of involves expressing that it's not that God is true God versus the other gods are false gods, but God is just valid and sure. He is faithful. He is reliable. He is trustworthy. And so when you apply amen to God, you're saying, amen, what you say is true and reliable and trustworthy and can be depended on. And so for Christ to be the amen, it's basically saying that Christ is not just true in the sense of not false, but it means he's faithful, he's accurate, he's reliable. What he says will happen, what he promises he will do. So the contrast is not so much true and false, but it's a contrast between reliable and unreliable, faithful and faithless. And so he's kind of trying to contrast who he is. He is the true and reliable one, the faithful one, in contrast to the Laodicean church, which is not so faithful, not so reliable, and not so true as Jesus is. Now, the phrase there that he is the ruler of creation, it kind of combines a couple things. That word that's translated ruler, arche, it kind of conveys the idea of the supreme authority, but also conveys the idea of the supreme authority because that person is the one who created or brought it into being. It is the origin of that. And if you're familiar, if you think about Colossians, you can hear some of those kind of phraseology coming up in Paul's letter to the Colossians. So it's likely that he said some of those same things in the letter Paul wrote to the Laodiceans. And so John was probably aware of that. He's visited that church. He knew that the church in Laodicea had a letter from Paul. They probably copied it and treasured it. And they probably had a copy of the letter from the church in Colossae too and treasured that. So he's kind of wanting to tap into some of those words that they were familiar with and had heard before. And so when he describes who Jesus is and who is speaking these words to them, it's the faithful one. It is that ruler of God's creation, the firstborn, the origin of it all. And then based on that, he says, I know your deeds. And again, sometimes when he says, I know your deeds, he's getting ready to say good things about you because they're great, like the church in Philadelphia. But here he says, I know your deeds, and he's not very impressed with them. He's not impressed with them at all. There's no word of commendation for the Laodiceans at all. But, you know, he's not criticizing them for false teaching or even, you know, kind of sexual morality like he does some other churches. The trouble is that the members are not hot or cold. And the thought of this is maybe the image is derived from the city's water supply, because it seems like their water came from hot springs that were a bit of a distance from the city. And so when the water got to the city, it was kind of lukewarm and kind of minerally, and it just wasn't something that was really good to drink. And as a result of that, a lot of times when people look at this passage, they think that he's describing that they didn't have real spiritual vitality. There was not a lot of spiritual fervor, you know, and as a result, they were just kind of lukewarm. They weren't really hot or cold. And we can understand why being lukewarm is bad, because you want to be hot. the little bit of confusion I find with that interpretation is that why would he want them to be cold? You know, he says, I know your deeds, you're neither hot nor cold. I wish you were one or the other. Well, why would he want them to be cold? Because cold would mean that they are completely dead. Why wouldn't he just say, I want you to be hot? Now, some people say the reason why he says hot or cold is because he hopes that if they're cold, maybe they will realize their spiritual poverty and repent. I'm still not sure about that, because you don't know that if they're cold, they'll repent. Why not say, I understand you're lukewarm, and because of that, I'm going to spew you out of my mouth, because that's all lukewarm water really is good for. But why not just say they're hot? Well, there's one scholar that's kind of come with a little bit different slant on this. And he says, you know, when Jesus starts talking here, he says, I know your deeds. He's talking about their actions. He's not necessarily talking about their temperament or their level of spiritual fervor. And he says, and he goes on to say, if you think about hot and cold, think about two cities that were close to Laodicea. There was Hierapolis, and that was a place that had really hot water and hot springs. And people would go there because they thought it was medicinal in nature. And it was like a bit of a tourism industry where you go and you soak in the hot springs, and the hot water is supposed to bring healing and to sicknesses. It had a medicinal purpose. And it says also the water in Colossae was well known too, because it was cold and crisp and just really a pleasure to drink. So one scholar thinks that really what he's saying here is, you know, hot water like you get in Hierapolis, that's really good because it brings about healing. And cold water like you get in Colossae, that's really good. But you guys are neither one of those. You're just kind of lukewarm, tepid, kind of blah, distasteful water. I wish you could be useful like the really hot water or useful like the really cold water. But because you're neither one of those, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. And, you know, it might be the traditional way of understanding it refers to kind of their spiritual fervor, whether they were lukewarm or zealous or really dead. But I kind of like this because it really taps into the concept of I know your deeds. And that would explain why he would say, I want you to hot or cold, because both of those would have been useful. But lukewarm wasn't. Now, it should be noted here that Jesus is basically saying, because you are lukewarm, not useful or not zealous enough, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. And that's pretty bad, because it conveys the concept of a rejection of them. But we're going to see that he gives them a chance to repent. So although he's threatening to do that and say that he's going to do that, they get a chance to repent. So that doesn't become their lot. And so we'll look at that in verse 17. He says, he goes on to give them some more reason about why they need to repent. And he's pointing out more of the problems they have. They basically are offensive to God because they say they're rich, they're wealthy, they don't need a single thing. They are secure in their affluence, and they're unaware of in reality that they are spiritually pitiful. They're poor, they're wretched, they're blind, they're naked. You know, their material wealth and how established they are causes them to think that they are better off than they really are spiritually. They make some pretentious claims, and not only that they were rich, but I have acquired wealth, that they are the ones that did it. No sense of owing it to God or being thankful for that. And that they don't need a thing. Well, gosh, what do you need God for? You know, we made ourselves wealthy. We don't need a thing. There's somewhat like some of the parables that Jesus talked about a people who said, you know, you should eat, drink, and be merry because I've laid up lots of treasures and good things for myself in years to come. And so the Laodiceans kind of really felt secure in their own spiritual attainment, in their material attainment. But the truth of the matter is that they are, and in the Greek, the they is very emphatic. The truth is they were the ones who were poor and blind and naked. They may have been people who looked down upon the poor and the blind and those that were naked, that were poorly clothed. But John, or Jesus, using John to write it down, says, no, you are poor, you are blind, you are naked. And it's frequently noted that the people in Laodicea, Christians and non-Christians, prided themselves in the financial wealth of the town and the extensive textile industry there and that popular eye salve that was imported around the world. And so it doesn't take much of an effort to see what's being talked about here, because that, you know, when Jesus talks about those things, he says you have naked, which means they need clothes. They need salve to put on their eyes, which means they can't really see. And he goes on to say that, you know, they need to buy the right kind of clothes because they're actually not very well clothed after all. And so that's what Jesus really says to them, is that even though you think you're okay, you really aren't. You're in a difficult situation and you need to deal with that. Instead of being smug and content, you need to do what Jesus wants them to do. they need to buy refined gold. Now, obviously, this is not material gold, nothing they can buy with their physical wealth. It's spiritual gold. And it's spiritual gold that comes from being tested and being found totally trustworthy. They need to get that. And the way you get that is by being faithful and devoted to Christ. You get it from Christ by sticking with him. They also need white clothes in order to cover their shame and their nakedness. And I think the key thing is here, not so much a contrast between the famous black woolen fabric that was made in Laodicea, but it's a contrast between righteous, being white, wearing white robes was conveyed the idea of being righteous, of being justified in God's sight. And they need to be clothed that way. And their material clothing is not going to help them. It's a spiritual thing. They've got to recognize their pity and they've got to get clothed from Christ. And then they also need that to cover their nakedness. Now, nakedness is a symbol of judgment and humiliation in the Bible in biblical times. But you can deal with that by receiving fine clothing. And a lot of times when you're given nice clothing, it's indication that you are being honored. And you can see that in the Old Testament, you know, when Joseph got his multicolored jacket or coat or robe, it was a sign of being honored. He was given some clothes that indicated he was a special person. And so the Laodiceans right now are walking spiritually naked. They need to understand their situation and they need to get the white robes of righteousness that really can't be purchased with anything. But humble repentance, annulling one's shameful position, and accepting the forgiveness that comes with Jesus Christ. And then they have the problem of spiritual blindness. And in spite of the fact that there were famous medical schools there, in spite of the fact that there was that Phrygian powder that was used throughout the world to treat your eyes and eye diseases, they had a spiritual problem. Their spiritual eyes weren't there, and therefore they needed to get something spiritually that would help them. Jesus and John, and you know, John 9 talks about him coming into the world so that the blind will see and those who think they see will realize that they're blind. And Jesus is saying right now to those people, they need to recognize their blindness. But once again, he says there's hope. Why? Because you can get things from me. You can buy from me refined gold, and that way you'll become rich, spiritually rich. You can get from me white clothes to wear that will cover your nakedness and your shame. And you can get something that will treat your eyes and make it possible for you to see again. So even though there's a lot of judgment on this church and pointing out their shortcomings, it's all because he has a desire for them to repent. And why is that? Well, the next verse tells us. It's those I love, I rebuke and discipline. Now, that's really interesting verse because it's somewhat kind of unexpected because when he's giving them this chastisement, you think, oh, Jesus doesn't like them very much. Jesus doesn't love this church. No, he loves this church. He loves this church just as much as he loves the other churches. Remember, this is one of the churches that has a lampstand that he's in the middle of. This is one of the churches that he's holding in his hand. So this is really a show of, in some sense, unexpected, but understandable personal affection. But what we have to realize, though, is that he loves them, but he wants them to repent because God hates evil. God wants people to be faithful. And actually, rebuking somebody and disciplining somebody is something that's done and should be done out being motivated out of love. You know, unfortunately, most of the time it's not done out of love, so people don't receive it very well. But the concept of God disciplining those he loves is throughout Scripture. You know, God's Scripture says that, you know, the Son is the one who's disciplined because the Father loves the Son. And when you look at life, usually the best athletes, the finest scholars are people who've had somebody put high expectations on them and expect a lot about them and kind of motivate them to live up to it. So the advice of the Laodiceans, therefore, is that they repent. That's make a big turn around and repent and get the right kind of attitude and devotion and earnestness toward the Lord. It's kind of interesting in the Greek, and it comes a little bit in the English, but the idea of repent is once and for all, turn around and change your direction, but then have that ongoing, continuous earnestness that continues seeking after God. And, you know, there's a call to repent throughout the letters. You know, many of the letters, they're statements to the churches that they need to repent. And notice, if you go back up there and you look at verse 9, those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline. And he's not saying that just to the church in Laodicea. He's saying that to you and me, that he loves us. So we should expect there'll be times that he will rebuke us and discipline us. You know, the Lord chastens, the Lord disciplines those whom he loves. And that's true for all Christians and no exceptions. you know, it may be a little harsher with the ones that are straying away and not being faithful, but it's something that he does for all of us. And then we get to verse 20, where that famous phrase, "Here I am, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person, and they will eat with me." And you also, you know, you're familiar with this famous painting, and this is Holman Hunt's Light of the World, you know, picture there. And, you know, we can see Christ there knocking on the door. I'm sure you've seen that painting before. Let's go back to the verse. Now, oftentimes this verse is used evangelistically, you know, for somebody who's lost, and basically saying that Jesus is knocking on the door of your heart, open up and bring him in. But in the context in Revelation, it's not really something that's addressed to unbelievers, but to believers that need to repent and turn back to God. Christ is saying, "I'm standing at the door," and it's not a little knock, you know, it's a repeated, continuous knocking. I'm knock, 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 basically wanting them to open up and invite him in. It's written to that church, but you know, what's a little bit different here is even though the letter is written to all the church, here it kind of gets narrowed and there's more of an appeal to the individual. "I stand at the door, knock. If anyone hears my voice," it doesn't matter if the whole church doesn't do it. It doesn't matter if a lot of them do it. If any one person hears my voice, heeds this warning, that person, I will open the door and I will come in and we will eat together. And so that open door is basically a way of saying anybody who repents, they open the door of their life up to me, I will come in and we will have close and intimate fellowship. And again, I think many of you know that in the ancient Jewish world, having a meal with somebody was more than just kind of refueling your energy tank to go back to work. When you ate with somebody, it was a symbol of affection and intimacy and confidence and of a close relationship. And that's why Jesus was criticized by the Pharisees when he would eat with sinners and tax collectors. They said, "No, don't do that, because you're showing that you accept them and value them and think they're worthwhile and important." You know, Peter was criticized by the Jerusalem Christians when he preached the gospel to a Gentile, but not just preaching the gospel, but also with eating with them. So the present verse conveys not just that he's going to come in, but you're going to have this close, intimate relationship, the kind of relationship you get when you actually have a meal together. Well, those that do that, those that repent, and those in other churches that didn't need to repent, those who are victorious, Jesus says, "I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I was victorious and sat down with my Father on his throne." To the victorious, those who are faithful, and to those who repented and became faithful, this promise that you're going to be with me on my throne. I myself was victorious. I sat down with my Father on his throne, and then you're going to sit with me on my throne. Now, this is obviously metaphorical language. I don't know if the millions of people that are saved with Jesus are all going to be able to sit on the throne with him. It's going to be a big throne. It's just a way of conveying the fact that we will be with him, that we will reign with him as he has promised. You know, there's different visions you're going to see of Christ. We've already saw him, you know, when he appeared with the blazing eyes. Well, we're going to see some other times in Revelation where he's pictured as a lamb standing before the throne of God. And sometimes he's described as being on the throne, and sometimes he's being described as sitting at the right hand of the throne. And the other times he was described as being in the midst of the lampstands. Well, he's not really all these at the same time. It's just that these are different visions, different symbols that convey different truths about Christ. And when you sit on the throne with Christ, when you're enthroned with him, it is saying that you are victorious and you're being rewarded by being right there with Christ in the middle of everything. Just like Jesus, sometimes he's on the throne, sometimes in the right hand. It just conveys the concept that he has positions of high honor, that he is God because he sits there with God. And so we don't need to try to find distinctions or try to figure out, well, how can he be sitting at the right hand of God and sitting on the throne at the same time? It's missing the point of symbolic languages. It's not supposed to be kind of neatly dovetailed together. It's supposed to give you truths. There are important facts. Christ is already enthroned. His messianic reign has already begun. It's not something that's going to start when he returns. He's already reigning from heaven. The world doesn't know it. They don't see it because they don't have the eyes of faith. But, you know, Peter in Acts 2, when he preached that sermon on the day of Pentecost, said this, that God has made him, Jesus, both Lord and Christ. He is Christ right now. He is Lord right now. He is reigning right now. And that's the one who we will be with if we are faithful, if we are victorious. And he got that position because of his obedience, his being faithful, fulfilling the mission, even to the point of death. And God gave him the name that's above every name. And those that are like him who are faithful, they too will be honored. And they too will be given a position of status and honor in the kingdom that is to come. Now, we may not experience it right now that Christ is Lord and King, but he's ruling there and he will return. And when he returns, he will put all of his enemies under his feet and his nature as king and ruler will be seen to everyone. The victorious one is assured of being a participant in Christ's future visible reign. And, you know, some people want to restrict this promise to just martyrs. The Bible doesn't restrict this promise just to martyrs. It's like all the other letters at the very end, they come up with the phrase, whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. So as the Spirit says this to the church in Laodicea, the Spirit also says it to all the churches. All the churches, both then and now, all the Christians who are victorious, who remain faithful and don't deny Christ, they will be the ones that will receive these promises, these rewards that are spoken about here, the Church of Laodicea, but are actually promises for all Christians, that we too will be with Christ and reign when he returns. Well, that brings us to the end of chapter 3. I'm going to tell you what we're going to do next week. Next week, we want to get into more of the distinction about the rapture. And it really boils down to this. Will the Christians, will the church be on the earth during the period of tribulation that is described in Revelation, or will the church be removed from the earth? And actually, Revelation does give us a lot of guidance to answer that question. So we're going to have to spend some time going to some other verses, other parts of Scripture, where the teaching gets finds some support, and then to analyze it and to see whether it's true or not. So what I would encourage you to do before next week is to read Daniel chapter 9 and also 1 Thessalonians 5, 1 through 11. And we're going to look at some more verses, but those will be some key verses that we'll talk about. So I want to encourage you to read those ahead of time so you're prepared for our discussion. Right now, let me pray, and then I'm going to stop.